look at an example in Ajax done a couple different ways, and it's going to demonstrate the different ways that you can pass data between the server and the client. Each of the ways has its own advantages and disadvantages, and I'll try to go over those as we go over the examples. I think I've said before, you know, whenever you're presented with alternatives, you know, there's going to be circumstances in which one of the alternatives is better than the other, and then there's going to be circumstances where the other is better. Because if there were only advantages associated with one of the options and no disadvantages, then there wouldn't be options, right? You just always do the one thing, you know. But so we're going to look at passing data using delimited data, which we've seen already. The quiz example that we went over used delimited data. In other words, we pass back several pieces of data, and they were separated by something. If I remember right, they were separated by commas in the case of the quiz. This example is going to do something similar. The next thing we're going to look at is XML data, where we're passing back is XML data. Essentially, the differences between the two is delimited works in very simple with very simple data, all right? So if you're only passing back a few things, a few pieces of data, then delimited is probably the way to go, all right? XML is good when there's sort of a hierarchy of data. And I didn't want to sort of come up with a real complicated example, so the example I gave really doesn't take all full advantage of XML, but it does show you the coding that you would use to implement XML. But really, like for example, if I was going to return a list of authors that had, each author had several books, and each book maybe there were several editions, you know, paperback, hardcover, whatever. There's a distinct structure there. I would have data for authors. Inside of that data for authors nested, I would have a list of their books. And inside that list of books, for each book, I'd have the list of editions, paperback, hardcover, or whatever. That's sort of a complicated structure, all right? There's relationships between the data, is maybe a different way to put it. There's a hierarchy of data. You have authors, books, editions. That is possible to represent using delimited data, but it's pretty tricky to implement using delimited data. It's much easier, actually, to implement that via XML. So we'll go over a simple example of XML, and we'll see, first of all, how to do it using delimited data, and then we'll see how to use it doing XML. Then we're going to look at something called JSON data, and JSON data is sort of between the two. It's not as complicated as XML. It's not as simple as delimited data. So, you know, it's sort of the medium, it's sort of the mama bear solution, right? One is complicated, one is simple, one is sometimes just right. All right, so let's pull down the example. Sorry I missed class Monday, I just was not feeling well. And I had intended to go, but at some point I realized I just couldn't make it in and function well that day. All right. I'm just moving some files around here, so never mind me. I'll turn the projector on in a second. I will post information about the final sometime next week. It'll be similar to the midterm, because you enjoyed that so much. All right, what I'd like to do first of all is I'd like to show you how this works. I'll give you an overview of this, and then we'll look at the specifics of the implementation. Actually, this is not the one I wanted. Okay, so we have three versions, the delimited, JSON, and XML. I'm going to move over the delimited version first. So the page that starts everything off is dictionary.html. So let me go and type in localhost dictionary. And this is similar to the predictive search function in Google. This is a translation between English and Spanish for mathematical terms. Kind of a weird example, I know. I wanted to come up with something that was simple but not trivial. All right. So I found a list of these terms and I did some manipulation of it and did my thing. All right. So the way this works is as I type in a letter, the drop-down fills up with the words in the dictionary that start with that letter. So the more letters I type, the more it narrows it down. I select the one I want, I click go, and then it shows me the translation into Spanish. So there's actually two AJAX requests here. Alright, there's actually two events that trigger, get the ball rolling and contact the server and do its thing. One is every time I type a character. So as I type a character, an AJAX request is made to the server to ask for the list of words that start with that letter. Alright, so as I type in that It narrows it down based on the characters I typed in. There's a second AJAX request made when I click go to get the translation. So there's two AJAX requests here. All right. So that's how it acts. Because we don't really study databases in this class, which is kind of unfortunate, if we had like an extra 2 weeks, I would probably spend it talking about databases. But since we don't talk about databases in this class, I don't use a database for the words. I instead use just a couple of arrays. All right. But know that if a more realistic solution, all these words would be in a database table, and I would do a query to pull up the stuff. As it is now, I am simply using an array. So let's look at the code and see what's going on with it. Oops. Let's start off looking at dictionary.html. First of all, notice I have two objects for the XML HTTP request. That probably isn't absolutely necessary, but I decided to do it anyhow, just because I wouldn't want one request interfering with another request. So because there's two AJAX requests on this page, I decided to make two request objects. Again, the way that these requests work, the first request should be done by the time the second request rolls around, but I didn't want to mess things up. So I create two objects. I use the same function to create both of them. And again, if you remember that function, look to see what browser that you're on. If you're on an earlier version of Internet Explorer, it creates the request object this way. For other browsers, it creates the request object that way. So when I'm done, HTTP and HTTP2 both contain the request object. Now, what is a request object? The request object is a pipeline between the client and the server. It's the way that the client and the server communicate. All right. So it's used to make the request. It's used to get back the response from the server. So, in my text box, I have an onKeyUp event. All right? You can actually trigger things based on the key being pressed and the key being released. All right? I want onKeyUp because, really, if I were to do onKeyDown, I would always be one character behind because the character doesn't actually get put in the text box until you release the key. All right, small point, I realize, but again, if I did it on onKeyDown, I would always be one character behind. So if I typed an A, it would see an empty string in the text box. If I typed an AB then, it would see an A. ABS, it would see AB, and so on. So by doing onKeyUp, I'm seeing the correct value of the text box. So when the user releases the key in that text box, so after the user has typed a character in, I call the function getWords, and I pass it this.value. What does this.value mean? What does it mean when I say this? This is used, I guess you could say it both ways, this is used in many programming languages. If I say this, yes.
In this case, they would be referring to the object.
Right. Right. It always refers to the object that the code is in. All right? So in Java, if I say this dot something, it's whatever object that code lives in. All right? And same thing in C#. In this particular instance, the code lives as part of that text box. So this.value means the value of the text box. This guy's value. All right. So again, sometimes that's confusing, and I can sort of see why, but wherever the code lives, that's the object it's talking about. So I'm calling this, and I'm passing it whatever value is in the text box. All right, so let's see what getWords does. GetWords, first of all, make sure a couple things. It makes sure that there's something in the field. All right. So the value of the text box gets placed in the argEntered. I look to see if the argEntered is equal to an empty string, or if the argEntered begins with a space. All right. And if it begins with a space or there's nothing in there, it simply clears out the dropdown. All right. So if I were to go here and click space, it clears out the dropdown. Or if there's nothing in there, if I type something in and I back up and I clear it out, it clears out that. That's what this means. Dropdown var dd equals document frm math dd words. This is a different way to refer to the dropdown. In the past in this course, we've used document get element by ID. And we could use that here as well. But another way to refer to form controls is by giving the name of the form and the name of the form element. So in this case, the name of the form is FRM math, and the name of the form element is DD words. So I can set that. I can set the number of options. The length of it I can set to 0. What does that do? That effectively clears out anything that's in the dropdown. So, if it starts with a space, or if it's an empty string, I blank out the dropdown. Otherwise, I perform a request. And here's the request that I do. Dictionary1.php ?word equals argEntered. So what does the request look like? The request looks like this. Dictionary1.php ?word equals followed by whatever I've typed in there. So if I typed in an A, it says word equals A. If I typed in an AB, it says word equals AB, and so on. All right. So that's the request that I get sent. So let's make sure that we have this down before we go on to the next part. I type in a letter in the text box. The onKeyUp event gets triggered. I call the getWords function and I pass it the value of the text box. So getWords, argEntered is the value of the text box now. I look to see if that argument is equal to an empty string, or if it's equal to, or if it begins with a space. If it is, then I clear out the dropdown. How do I clear out the dropdown? Well, I point to the dropdown using sort of this alternative syntax, not get element by ID, but using the name of the form followed by the name of the form element. And then I say DD, which is the dropdown, options length equals 0. Effectively, what that does is that gets rid of all the options. All right, DD options length is how many elements are in the dropdown, how many options are in the dropdown. So if I set the option length to 0, that gets rid of all the options that are there. If I've typed something in there, though, I make a request. And that request is simply dictionary1.php ?word=argEntered. So the request is going to look like this. Dictionary1.php ?word=, followed by the value of the text box. I set the onReadyState change method to createDD. So when that AJAX request is done, createDD gets triggered. Finally, I actually make the request. All right. Any questions at this point? If I were debugging this, if it wasn't behaving the way that I would like it to, what would I do? I would put in an alert here to make sure the request was what I expected it to be. So that's the URL of the request. I would put an alert in here to see if that was what I expected it to be. So I type in an A, and there's a request, dictionary1.php ?word=A. So, yeah, the request is what I would expect it to be. And it fills that in. Okay. Good idea to comment out your debugging code, because you never know when you're going to need it. All right? So I'm going to comment that out and move it over. So now we're ready to look at the server. We made the request. All right. Here's the server-side code. Dictionary1.php. It includes a dictionary INC. All right. This dictionary INC is the list of the arrays of the Spanish and English terms. All right. Again, were I doing this in, you know, if we had more time this semester and we used a database, the database code would be in this ink. It's important that we'll notice that this dictionary INC is both in the code, the server-side code for the first AJAX request, and it's in the server-side code for the second AJAX request, right? It makes sense that those two would need the same arrays, would need the same code to pull up the words. Right, because we wouldn't want those two things to get out of sync. So let's look at the include file. The include file consists of two what are called parallel arrays. Does anyone know what a parallel array is? Actually, two parallel arrays are. You can't have one parallel array. A parallel array is where the first element of one array corresponds to the first element of the other array. So I have two arrays, English and Spanish. If I look at this, right down the line, element 0 of the English array corresponds to element 0 of the Spanish array. And so on down the line. All right, so that's what it means by a parallel array. All right. So for this to work, there needs to be the same number of elements in each array, and the elements have to match up. Element 0 in the English array has to match up element 0 in the Spanish array. 1 in English has to match 1 in Spanish. 2 in English, 2 in Spanish. All the way down for all of the elements in the array. All right. So that's the first thing I have in here, is I have those two parallel arrays. I grab the value of the query string, all right, which is the characters that have been typed into the text box. I assume that we don't find any words, because that's a case that I have to handle as well, right? A lot of times you're going to have a lot of code for sort of the exception or the weird processing. In other words, what if there's nothing in the text box? I have code to handle that. What if they type in a string that doesn't exist? So what if I type something weird like that? Well, I want to handle that gracefully. I don't want it to blow up. I want to give a clear message of what's going on. So I'm setting a flag saying, all right, let's assume there aren't any until I find one. And then I loop through the array. All right, I loop through the English array. Because what I'm looking for is I'm looking for words in English that match the character string I typed in. So if I type in A, I want to return all these A's. If I typed in AB, or let's say AD, I want to return all those ADs, and so on. So I'm going to loop through all the English terms. I then look to see if the position of the word in the English array element is equal to 0. Right, it's a little bit tricky code for a couple reasons. Let's take a minute to make sure we understand that. First of all, your eyes aren't failing you. There's 3 equal signs there. All right? So we'll come back to talk about what 3 equal signs mean. All right? Now, what the strspos function does, the str inside of this string. So, let's say I type in AB, forget the capitalization here, and I perform that function and its absolute value. When I do that string position, if these are the values, it's going to return the starting character if there's a match. So, AB matches absolute starting with character 0. So, AB matches character 0, starting at character 0 of absolute. What if I did SOL? What would the value be? Well, doesn't match here, doesn't match here, it matches here. So SOL matches these characters in here. So this is character 0, the A is character 0, B is character 1. SOL starts in character 2. So this function would return a 2 for this. So AB would return a 0 because it matches a 0. ABS would return a 0. ABSO would return a 0. L would return 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. If I typed in something that doesn't match, it would return a false, maybe a negative 1. PHP is kind of weird, all right? Because remember, PHP is weakly typed. If I tested it against a Boolean, it would return false. Okay, so let's look at my if statement. I'm looking to see if it equals 0. Alright? So I'm looking to see if this string, what I've typed in the text box, matches the word in the array, starting with the first letter of the word. I'm not interested if it's somewhere else in the word, right? So if I were to type in value, I don't want absolute value, right? Because the way that I have termed this, I want things that begin with the string that I've typed in. So this will return a zero if it matches the string at the beginning of the string that I'm trying to match. So if it's equal to zero, then I have a match. And I'm going to output the value to the client. All right? If it doesn't match, if the value is something other than zero, it skips that word. So, you know, all the words that don't begin with ABS, it's going to skip those. Now, why the three equal signs? All right? The three equal signs in PHP means it needs to match the value and the type. All right? Because you could write some weird if statements in PHP where you compare an integer to a Boolean. You can do it because it's a weakly typed language. All right? This function, strpos, returns sometimes an integer and sometimes it returns a Boolean. That's crazy, right? Those of us that have done C-sharp coding or Java coding. But the strpos function in PHP may return a false, but it may also return a value which evaluates the false. So, blah, 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 use the equal, equal, equal. So, I'm really looking for a numeric zero, not some kind of weird value that means false, where PHP is converting a Boolean into an integer. All right? So, that's why I use the three equal signs. I want it to really, truly be a numeric zero and not just a Boolean that got converted to a numeric zero. All right? So I'm using a 0, 0, 0, or equal, 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 0 in there. So it's only going to find the things that are at the very beginning of there. Now, what do? I output the English word, a semicolon, and the value of I. What's the value of I? The value for I is the position inside the array. Alright? So, for example, if I were to type in AB, it would return absolute value, semicolon, 0, because absolute value is the first element in the array. And by the way, if I have a match, then I know B none equals false. If it made it all the way through the loop and it didn't find anything, I'm only going to output one string that says no words match this pattern and a value of negative 1. All right? So I'm going to get one of two things. I'm either going to get a list of words followed by their position in the array, or I'm going to get the phrase, no words match this pattern, followed by a negative 1. So, the good news is we can test this. We can run this from the address bar and see exactly what we get. So I'm going to type in dictionary 1, PHP, question mark, word equals A. And that's what I get. I get a list of delimited data. Each word consists of two pieces. All right? A word, a semicolon, and a value. The value corresponds to the position in the array. So, absolute value is in position 0 in the array. Accuracy is in position 1. Addition is in position 2, and so on. The more I type in, the more it narrows it down. right? If I type in AD, addition is in position 2, additive is in position 3, and so on. So this is what I get back from the server. Now if I type in something that doesn't exist at all in the server, arrays, I get no words match this pattern in a negative 1. All right. So I either get a list of words, each word is separated by a colon, each word has two parts to it, the word itself followed by the position in the array. So server-side code is pretty simple, all right? In my mind, it's simple compared to the client-side code. The client-side code is more involved. In fact, when we look at the XML version of this, really, it's not much different than this. The only thing is instead of outputting something that looks like this, it's going to output XML that contains that. All right, so this is what gets sent back to the client. And again, if I wanted to debug this, what I would do is, first of all, I would do this and type in the URL with the query string and make sure the server returns what I expect. Or I could do this. I could put an alert in here that displayed the value that the server sent back to the client. So, if I type in an A, that's what I get back. So I know I'm getting back what I'm supposed to be getting back, because this looks like what I said I was going to get. If I type in an AD, then that's what I get. All right. And again, I'm going to go and I'm going to comment that out because I might need this debugging code at some point in the future again. So now let's look to see what I do. All right. Set a variable called AOption. I point to the dropdown again, same way that I did before, right? And I set the option length to 0. So I get rid of anything that was in the dropdown before. I then do a split on an array. What does a split on an array do? It takes and splits a string into an array. So it makes an array out of strings. Now in this case, what am I using to split the array, or to split the string? I'm using a colon. Where do we have the colon? The colon is between each word. So when I run the split, A English is going to be going to contain these elements. The first element in A English is going to be addition, semicolon, 2. The second element is going to be addition, semicolon, 3. Or additive, semicolon, 3. Additive identity, semicolon, 4. Additive inverse, semicolon, 5. So the first split, splitting by colon, is going to go and create an array where each of these things is an element. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to loop through for every word that's in that element, every element in that array, so every word. I'm going to split it again, all right? Because the first element here is going to be this, so I want to separate out the word part from the number part. And I'm going to use that to create an entry in my dropdown. Now, guess what? This is going to be the part that the user sees, the word part. This is going to be the value of the option. And that's what I do right here. I create a new option in my dropdown. I add to a dropdown really is simply a list, an array of options. So DD options, DD length, DD options length. So I'm adding on to the end of it each time. The first time through, DD options length is 0. So the first time I add option 0. The second time through this loop is going to have a value of 1. So I'm going to add to element 1 and so on. I create a new option. Whereas what's going to be displayed to the user is in array element A, or 0. And what the value of it is in array element 1. So the bottom line is when I'm done with this, I have a dropdown where what's visible is the word part and what is the value is the index of the array. All right, I want to wrap this up. So we'll look at the very last part of it. Even if we go a little bit longer. So right now we have a drop down. So let's go here. I type in, oops, let me copy that over. So I have a drop-down. What I see is addition. Behind the scenes, the value of that option is whatever element of the array it is, the index of the array. So I select it and click go, get the Spanish translation. What am I doing there? Well, on my on-click, I have get translation. I grab the value that was selected from the dropdown. Again, this is an alternate way of grabbing the value from the dropdown. I look to see if that value is negative 1. If it's negative 1, then there's a message that says, hey, you know, there's no valid words. Otherwise, I call dictionary 2, and I pass it the value of the index. On ready state change, I call display translation. I send null. All that dictionary 2 does is look up the value of that array for that element and returns it to the client. And then all the client does is it takes what it got back. Takes what it got back from the server and puts it in this results, the inner HTML. So that second AJAX request is real, real, real straightforward. I'm giving the index in the array. It simply looks up that index in the Spanish array, returns the Spanish translation. The client simply takes that Spanish translation and displays it on the page. All right. My suggestion would be to review this because there's a couple of different things that are going on in it, the way that we're splitting the data, what we're doing on the PHP side. I will make sure all of the versions are posted, so if you want to be adventurous, look next at the XML version of it, because the XML version is where we're going to pick up on Monday of next week. All right? Any questions? All right, we'll see you in lab.